Let's talk about this strange article from The Atlantic. Nintendo's sad struggle for survival. Facing an uncertain future, the company keeps trying to mine its storied past by Ian Bogost. So, this is a strange article, a little pretentious, not just because the guy's using $5 words and really wore out his thesaurus while writing it, but because he's melding together the story of what Nintendo was versus what it is now and the strategy going forward. Talking about what we all know about Nintendo helped save the North American video game market, and then the games were cartoony like Super Mario Brothers, Duck Hunt, Legend of Zelda. They were innocuous, and then Nintendo didn't grow up. Gaming changed around them with Doom and Mortal Kombat and blah 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 blah. So, but then he talks about the NES Classic Edition and goes off the fucking rails here. His main quote here, and the one that's highlighted, is: "To buy an NES Classic Edition isn't to express an interest in playing classic Nintendo games again, so much as it is a totem." And a totem's a fucking symbol if you don't want a thesaurus. That's such a pretentious statement because the author is assuming he knows the motivations of everyone buying the NES Classic Edition. He's assuming that the casual person off the street that hasn't played an NES in 25 years just wants a little mini version just because of how the console looks versus remembering fondly playing Tecmo Bowl or playing Ninja Gaiden or Mega Man 2 or one of the other 30 games on the console. That just turns my stomach. And it's not because it's cynical, it's because it's wrong on the surface. I'll bring up that story again about that 55-year-old in the sushi restaurant when I was with Frank in the summer. He brought up the NES Classic Edition to me. To me. He knew about it. I know people that their coworkers are bringing up. These aren't retro gamers saying, "Oh, I'm excited for this." Were they excited about this because it looks like a fucking a mini NES because it's a totem? Or do they actually want to play those games again? Well, the author's deciding for us that it has nothing to do with the games. Absolutely not. No, they want a miniature NES that they can put on their fucking shelf. That's an insane statement, just false on its surface. Because if that's the case, why bother putting games on the damn system at all? Why go out and choose 30 of the best games possible that they could get the licensing for? Mega Man 2, Ninja Gaiden, Super Mario Bros. 1, 2, and 3, Zelda 1 and 2, Metroid. Why go out and even bother paying money to license those third-party games? Super C. Couldn't get Contra for some reason, but Super C. Galaga, Pac-Man. These are good games. This is not a fucking cash-in by any means when it comes to the games selected. I was impressed by the games. Couple of questionable choices overall, but Tecmo Bowl? Yeah, people don't have interest in playing these games. What was the average rating again, according to a certain NES guidebook? Four, like, it's like 4.25 stars? The average game included with this? No, people aren't interested in those games at all. It's a fucking little totem. It's a symbol of my nostalgia. Are you kidding me? He writes, Ian, not our Ian, but this Ian from The Atlantic. "The experience of the games themselves are less important than the sight and feel of the thing. You have a Nintendo." Again, his opinion. Like, where does that come from? Where does that come from? Do you think that little kid that wants to play the system cares that it's a little that the color is gray and ugly? The NES looks like fucking garbage. If you want to get down to it, it's not an attractive looking system. When it came out, we didn't think, "Oh, look how sleek and sexy the NES is, that gray fucking box." And the reason they picked gray, according to my engineer friend, is because gray plastic, at least back then, was the cheapest plastic you could get. And that's probably also why the game cartridges were gray. Because that's a cheap plastic. The Sega Master System was a sexy system. Genesis. Super Nintendo was a little bit better, still gray. The NES was not a cute, sexy system. So I don't know what you're talking about there. So again, to buy an NES Classic Edition isn't to express an interest in playing classic Nintendo games again, so much as it is a totem from which to recall the context in which those games were once played. That is insane. So what he's saying is the games themselves are important, but you want to remember that nostalgic feeling of playing them on your couch and your console TV when you were young. again, then why? Then okay. But I have an NES already, and I still wanted the NES Classic Edition because I thought it was a good product, but I guess he's speaking not to the people who already have an NES. Okay. Or for younger players who have never encountered the system in its heyday, onto which to project a firmly stable, if utterly invented, context against which to contrast the anxiety of the present. I'll read that bullshit statement again, because if you didn't understand it, then I didn't either, but I'll try to get by into it. Or for younger players who never encountered the system in its heyday, onto which to project a firmly stable, if utterly invented, context against which to contrast the anxiety of the present. What anxiety are you speaking of? What does that mean, Ian? What's the anxiety? The anxiety is me trying to get through this horseshit article. That's my anxiety right now. The younger players, the 5 and 10 year olds, and I've seen the pictures of parents with their kids, so they exist. Parents wanting to share their video game experience with them. There's no anxiety for those kids. They want to play Super Mario Bros. 3 on their LCD TV. Maybe their parents are telling them, hey, when I grew up, we didn't have games played on a mobile device. You know? There was no Xbox One. It was an NES, a great clunky system. And yes, while it looks kind of similar to what I had, I really want to impart these awesome games to you, like Mega Man 2. And maybe not Ghosts and Goblins. You know, but Excitebike. You'll have fun playing these simple games. That's the goal. There's no anxiety with that. What's the anxiety? He then goes into this really fucking weird story about Cliff Bleszinski, who worked on games of Gears of War, working in Blaster Master, and how it was the game he was playing when he learned of his father died. And it just goes off on a fucking tangent that doesn't really lend itself to anything. It should have been cut from the story entirely. I don't know where the editor was here. In retrospect, it's obvious that Nintendo has been a company mining its own nostalgia even as it goes through the motions of innovation and reinvention. Every medium does that. Bands re-release albums' greatest hits. Movies re-release director's cuts and ultimate cuts like Blade Runner or in Star Wars, 40 freaking different versions on VHS, DVD, and Blu-ray. Why is that bad? You want to make money. I don't understand. That's bad? So it's going through the motions of innovation. The Wii wasn't innovative. You might think that the Wii is horseshit and that it was quote-unquote a casual system. But to say that it was going through the motions, it literally was motions of innovation. Literally, Ian. Not our Ian, this Ian. It was literally motions of innovation that made the company fucking billions of dollars. It sold over 100 million consoles. That's insane. The most successful game console ever. The motions of innovation. What does that fucking mean? And then he says that like Super Mario Run is strange because they allowing a company like Apple to police its games. Apple's not policing Super Mario Run. They're just letting it go on its platform. Google's not going to be policing Super Mario Run when it comes to Android when it's on the Google Play Store. Nintendo could have put any game they damn well pleased on a mobile device, and any company, Apple, Google, whatever, are going to allow it. They could have put I don't know. What's the worst black box game that you can think of off the top of your head? Stack Up. They could have put Stack Up on here and put a Rob in the corner to do the commands for, and it would have been on the Apple devices just fine. Apple would have nothing to say about it. They could have put Super Mario 1, 2, and 3 on here and put an awful control pad that would have made the game unplayable and charged $60, and Apple would have no say in the matter at all. That is just a false, pretentious statement that makes no sense. Yes, Miitomo was a curious app more than a game. We know that. Even before issuing the first jump, the player must accept Nintendo's terms of service and privacy policy. Yeah, welcome to real life. That happens with any game system you purchase nowadays. There's a terms of service involved. any game you buy, for the most part, has terms and service you must accept. That's not a point you're making. You're trying to say, like, Nintendo's sacrificing its legitimacy somehow by doing an app game that's going to make them tens of millions of dollars in profit. Like, that's bizarre, again. The apparatus built around the game produces even more cognitive dissonance, from the article. I'm getting cognitive dissonance reading this. Talking about the complex account and game setup procedure stands between downloaders and their first running of the Mario. Has this guy bought a console in the past 8 years? And games? When you buy a game console, you can't just, like, plug it in and start playing. It's got to update, like, twice, three times, restart multiple times. You have to create your own account, agree to the terms of service, hook up the internet to it, make your account. This has... No one downloaded Super Mario Run thinking, oh my god, this is taking so long to do this. You gotta be kidding me. Compared to any other sort of gaming device. Like a 3DS or something. Every device, you gotta go through this now. Unbelievable. He called Super Mario Run tone deaf. The video game equivalent of listening to your grandparents using outmoded slang that might have sounded acceptable at another time and place. Modern players will just want to hide their heads. So then what should they have done? What should they have done instead of this game? Would you want them to take their game library and slap it on here? Like they did with the virtual library, the eShop, virtual console and eShop? No, that's not going to happen. No, I think this was fine. This protects their IP. It makes them money. People are happy. It's getting good reviews so far. Well, it remains to be seen if people get sick of it. Whole other issue. And while I'm at it, because you complained, author, about the totem of the NES Classic Edition, what would you have preferred the NES Classic Edition look like if not a miniature NES? The water bottle in my hand? Would that have made more sense? This hat I have on. A Santa hat. Maybe I'll hook up the HDMI output to that. What would you have preferred the NES Classic Edition look like? Because I'm just curious about that. If not a miniature NES or an NES type of console. What makes the most sense for marketing? To make it look like the original? Or some random fucking sock I have laying on the ground? Because I really don't know what kind of point you're trying to make with that. And that just hit me in the head. From what is Mario running in Super Mario Run? Oh, this is where it gets poignant. The answer is as obvious as it is tragic. From the smartphone itself. And in this contest, any victory is pyrrhic. For Nintendo to succeed on iOS is also to admit that its expensive hardware business might be inessential. But to fail on smartphones would only deport Mario and his crew back to the poverty of that very business. Nintendo is trapped. No wonder the company is looking back to the 1980s for relief as much as its fans. This is insane. It's like this author either doesn't know or is ignoring the fact that the Nintendo Switch is coming out in 3 fucking months. It was just on the Tonight Show and seen by millions and millions of fucking people. The best PR I've seen Nintendo do on anything for the past 10 years. People are hyped about the Nintendo Switch. That's undeniable. Whether or not it's going to be underpowered, it's not going to live up to expectations, people are buzzing about this fucking console. Way more than the Wii U. Nintendo has to put out this new console. Wii U is dead. That was a failure. 3DS was a pretty damn good success. But that's been dying out because it's been out for like 5 years and people are going to move on. Nintendo has dominated the handheld market for like 25 years. They've dominated it. But they put out a new iteration every 3-4 years at least. So they've not admitted their expensive hardware business is inessential. If that was the case, what the fuck's the Nintendo Switch for then? Nintendo's never going third party ever. You're never going to see Nintendo give up their first-party hardware. Because they're a toy company. Toy and video game company. They're not. That's their strength. The reason Nintendo is going to exist far after everyone listening to this podcast is dead. And by the way, they've already been around for like 125 fucking years. The reason they're going to continue to exist is because the massive success of the Wii. Because of the hardware. Why would they give that up? Because they had one bad stumbling block with the Wii U. 3DS was a massive success. DS success. Game Boy success. Every console has been at least a minor success. Except for the Wii U, which they probably took a bath on, and the Virtual Boy, which, well, that was just fucking awful and abysmal. But they realized it and cut it after like 8 months and got it off the market. Other than that, the other 15 consoles Nintendo have put out have all been successes. Like 3 out of 15, that's not a fucking bad track record for hardware, is it? Absolutely not. Especially when the second to last one was the biggest piece of hardware ever created for video games in terms of sales. And to say that they're trapped because they're going to a smartphone app, this is actually probably overdue to their shareholders. And to everyone enjoying the app, saying, "Oh, this is cool. This is pretty inventive to get Nintendo IPs onto a smartphone." And it's not debasing it. It's something keeping within the universe of Mario and protecting the IP at the same time. Let's see a comments right here, real quick. TurboTastic. This is probably the best response I see. Magazines have been publishing Nintendo is doomed because it doesn't mindlessly imitate everything its competitors do articles since the mid-90s. It's all very predictable, as is the idea that somehow Nintendo is pathetic because it banks on nostalgia. Ignoring the fact that the entire entertainment industry is currently built on that idea, and it's nothing new either. Disney has been using nostalgia to market its properties for at least 50 years, and they seem pretty healthy. Super Mario Run is kind of a mess, mind you. Its biggest problem isn't even mentioned in this article, and that's how it asks you to pay $10, a huge price for a phone game, and doesn't even give you full access. The game only works if you're connected to the internet, which I brought up in my review. If you want to play on an airplane or during a subway commute or just someplace with spotty Wi-Fi, too bad. And denying consumers full access to software they paid money for is not a good look. But the idea that this is somehow going to sink Nintendo, a company that owns several of the most valuable pop culture franchises in the entire world, is absurd, especially with the latest console, the Switch, generating a huge amount of positive interest. By the way, Pat here, by the way, I don't know, 3 huge Universal theme parks coming in California, in Orlando, and in fucking Japan in time for the Olympics there in 2020? Are you nuts? Nintendo's on top of the world right now. They are not struggling for survival. What an insulting, just brain-dead article, if I may say. Not to take it too personally, but this writer had an agenda, a big agenda, and ignored the facts or twisted them to suit what he wanted to try to accomplish here. But no one is fooled by this.